I'm Carolyn Ball, and I came here in 1991, and I worked for the state of Indiana. I was a performance standards analyst, so I had 5 years' experience working for the state, and I'd also worked for a hospital as a personnel recruiter, and I'd also worked for the Girl Scouts and for a nonprofit that helped veterans get into health careers and into school. I never could have done it with just my PhD in political science. And my management classes came from the business school at Purdue University called the School of Management there. My family had a house in Southwest Harbor, which is about an hour and 15 minutes. So I had a place to stay. So it wasn't very hard for me to move here from Indiana in that sense.
Finishing my undergraduate and graduate degrees, BA and master's in foreign affairs at the University of Virginia, there was a part-time research job that was good because it was called the Institute of Government, and I think that was my first research aspect when I was still at the University of Virginia. And so I got those degrees, and later I joined the part-time Army Reserve and worked in strategic and counterintelligence. This was the Vietnam type of era. My wife and I then moved to the University of Colorado, also called CU, such that to get my PhD, I had a wonderful opportunity to to be a visiting assistant professor of political science at another university in Denver called Metropolitan State College. So we were out there for 3 years, and I hadn't quite finished my PhD, so but we came back to UMaine and finished it that semester, the first one.
I began in 1996, so I've been here 15 years. This is my second career. My first career was with the Internal Revenue Service, where I lasted 28 years, took an early retirement, and my wife worked for a year while I looked for a job. The job turned out to be here, so she took her retirement, and I went back to work. So I started actually when I was an undergraduate, a junior, back in Weber State in Ogden, Utah, and they were opening a new IRS facility. So I needed part-time work, and that was the best pay in the area. I went to IRS and spent several years in Ogden, several years in Washington, D.C., a little bit of time in Florida, and somehow I ended up coasting up I-95 to Orono, Maine.
I'm Ed Laverty. I've been officially associated with the Department of Political Science and then the Department of Public Administration here at the University of Maine since September of 1977. My association with the university and particularly public administration goes back substantially before that. My grandfather and my father both graduated from the University of Maine. My grandfather in 1896, I believe it was, in engineering, and my father in 1936 in forestry engineering. So I came to the University of Maine with a real strong sort of family tradition. I initially, though, graduating from high school, I was enlisted in the Marine Corps and ended up in a special educational program that they were designing, and went to the Citadel. I went to basic training in Parris Island and then went to the Citadel in Charleston, South Carolina, where I was supposed to get a 4-year Class A education, as they call it at the time, Marine Corps. And I was at the Citadel for a year, and then through a snafu in the Marine Corps, we all got activated and that whole thing dissolved. And the next thing I knew, I was not only out of the Citadel, but out of the Marine Corps. And I came back to Millinocket, where I'm originally from, worked in the mill, in the paper mill, making paper. And I decided that wasn't what I wanted to do. So then I came back to the University of Maine Knights, eventually completed my undergraduate degree here. There was a brand new program being offered by the Department of Political Science at the time, and it was his master's in public administration. And Roy Shin, who had been hired from the University of Indiana to come here to create this new master's program, pretty much corralled me. And if you knew Roy Shin, he said, you're going to do this master's program, and I did this master's program. So I got an MPA from the University of Maine. I then went on into the military and then into a PhD program at the State University of New York, finished that at the Rockefeller Institute, and had a few teaching jobs. And then again, Roy Shin contacted me, invited me to come back to Orono and teach the methods seminar. So I've been through the entire history of the department, because shortly thereafter, a couple of years after that, the Department of Political Science and the Public Administration Program separated and became the Independent Department of Public Administration, and I went with that because I had an enduring interest in public administration.
The janitor put up a clock. The clocks kept being stolen in 235 North Stevens, and he found a traditional kind of round clock and he put it up, and then that disappeared and he put up another one. And finally he found a clock that says bath, and that was up on the wall for a long time. I always took pictures of my classes, or at least since 1998, I guess, and we all enjoyed the cracks in the walls. Ed had the experience of having the wall actually fall.
We had the best internship program. Dr. Edward F. Dow started the program in World War II and all the way up to where he was finishing it out when I was coming in, and it was the first, as we know, BA public management program in the nation, and after that about 100 colleges and universities took the lead in following. So that was really a good point. And we were very pioneered by the NASPA group to bring the MPA accreditation to UMaine and other universities. And we went through that process after 1986. You have like cycles, and we went through six cycles up to the present, and we still have two or three more that are still open. So it was a very good experience, because even today, probably only half a dozen ones do accreditation nationally, as opposed to accreditation to your own internal relations at the university. So that was a major thing, and we worked on. We were very proud of what we did.
The first impression was when I came. It was in April, and it had snowed here, and a grad student picked me up at the airport, took me to, and stayed at the Sheraton, and brought me up here to campus. Explained that the roads didn't always look like this. Dropped me off at the building and told me it was up on the second floor. And I came and looked at the hallway and I thought, where's the rest of the building? Where's the rest of it? I had been used to, in Washington, the IRS National Office, the downtown part of the National Office, is two blocks in each direction with an interesting configuration. It's not as big as the Pentagon, but it isn't a tiny place. And it was interesting to see a hallway that was maybe six doors on a side each direction. So that was my very first thought of, this is where the place is. The faculty took me out to dinner and during the interview process, and I started seeing the people for who they were, and not just somebody who was talking to me all day long and asking me questions all day long, but it was a conversation. And I was impressed with the characters, and I was impressed with the breadth of knowledge that everybody seemed to bring. And I thought, wow, this is good. Also during the interview process, I met a set of graduate students who were, in effect, interviewing me. And they were on top of things. They were really smart young men and women. And I thought, this would be a nice place to be. So it turns out they offered me the job. I took this job, and I haven't looked back.
My first memory of UMO is, quite frankly, it wasn't my memory, but on the day I was born, my father was at a Colby, University of Maine Colby football game here on campus. So I guess it's sort of, you know, from the womb to... But we used to come here for reunions, and my father had long-lasting affiliations with people that he met here at the university, so it was always sort of a part of my life. And again, because my grandfather was from here as well, it was sort of like a, almost like a part of my family. Mm-hmm. I remember being called before the Dean of Students, Dean John Stewart, for two major infractions that got me in huge trouble. Number one, I had a car on campus that I hid. As a first-year student, you weren't supposed to have cars. I get caught with that. Actually, there were three things. And the second thing was that in the spring, one spring, myself and this other guy took a canoe. We put the canoe in the river up here at Stillwater and took it down past the university. And that was considered to be a wild and crazy thing to do. So we got in trouble for that. And the other thing was, Dean Rand, who was at the time John Stewart's assistant, was driving his car on College Avenue, myself and this other guy were in a snowball fight, and I threw a snowball and hit his car.
This is an interesting thing. For those of you who remember a show called Northern Exposure, I liken Orono to Sicily, Alaska, with a university in it. I can actually picture a moose wandering down the street on Mill Street sometimes during the middle of the winter. And it has that rusticity, and it has the intellectual atmosphere all at the same time. It's a great combination. And in fact, the whole Maine experience has been marvelous from my point of view.
So when I first came here, the University of Maine was a very, very, very close-knit community. It was a residential campus. There were very few commuters. People lived on campus. Everybody knew the Stein song. Everybody knew the history of the university. Everybody knew the names of the presidents. And there was also a time when it was in local parentis, when, like, for example, which meant that you came here and the university was your surrogate parents. Deans came from the faculty, and presidents came from the faculty, and it was an era of faculty governance. I mean, every 2 weeks there'd be a college meeting and all the faculty would come, and they'd define policy for the deans, who then sit at the dean's council and define policy for the president. So it was really, it was a very decentralized sort of town meeting type thing. The student union was literally a student union. It was owned and operated by students. The purpose of the bookstore was to get students the best buy possible by using their collective purchasing power to buy books. The Bears Den provided food at, you know, almost no cost at all to students. Mid-1980s into the 1990s, the university began to professionalize. We began to bring in professional deans whose career track was to be a dean, come here as a step to somewhere else. Profit centers took over the university. The student union was essentially usurped by the administration, probably for good reasons at the time, I don't know. Faculty governance changed substantially. It became a real top-down entity. There was more emphasis on commuting students living off campus. The parietal and local parentis thing ended. I mean, there used to be dorm mothers in every dorm, and you know, you had curfews and all that stuff. All that went away. And as that went away, the university sort of melted into the community, had less of an individual identity, and became more sort of like a professional sort of institution as almost indistinguishable from any other institution. And it became larger. The culture shifted dramatically. I, as a student here, used to go to faculty members' houses for dinner. You know, faculty would invite you. We'd have classes, of course, you know, class meetings in people's homes. That all pretty much went away. But that wasn't dissimilar from what was going on in any other university in the country. Big as far as the greater community is concerned, same thing, sort of mirrored the evolution of the university, very closely integrated into the university. I mean, Pat's was part of the university. I mean, I forget the name of the clothing store in Old Town where everybody used to buy their clothes. This whole area was part of the university. A sort of town and gown mentality began to develop, and people in the surrounding communities were not as receptive to university students or faculty. And I mean, there were exceptions. I want to be careful about that. But again, just as the university began to become sort of more institutionalized, sort of the relationship in the community. But I think there's always been and because we employ so many people here at the university, it is the employment center for Old Town primarily.
It's a detriment to the state as a whole, particularly for public management at the town level. It's a job that's here to stay. It will continue. It's a detriment to not have merged and to kept us. And it was a detriment not to merge us, which is what I pushed for during this long 2-3 years where they talked about closing the department. And then there were 4 of us here and 3 approximately at retirement age. So it would have been ideal for strategic planning, and we do teach strategic planning. So the demand will always be here, but the students, the future of won't have that opportunity to go in town management because they won't know about town management. So I'm very disappointed. I'm also disappointed because our students do transfer from sector to sector, so we have a lot of students that go from nonprofit to state to local, and so that's not unusual either. So you really see our students throughout the Maine. Certainly students go beyond Maine, but most of them are in Maine or the greater New England area. So we won't see that opportunity to provide a place through the University of Maine for our future leaders in nonprofits and in government, which is a real shame.
It was a real shock, but incrementally, the powers that be stripped away at our program over the last 4 years. It's sad that the higher-ups don't seem to understand how well we can place students with good jobs, especially in this economy, and both at the undergraduate and graduate levels.
I was really disappointed when we couldn't manage to keep the department going and to keep the programs going in some major way. I'm not disappointed in the department per se, or in the students, because I think they've been outstanding and widely respected actually on a national level, but in the decisions that got made that I'm very disappointed in, as I think everybody here who's listening to this recording is disappointed. The United States was born of a skepticism about government and how governments run, and this has been part of our culture throughout our history, not just the 200 years plus that we've been the United States of America, but prior to that we had our run-ins, let's say, as colonists too, and skepticism about government. So what you're seeing now, both here at the institution and also in the public's discussion, is what you're going to hear probably as long as the U.S. remains what it is. It'll be this skepticism about government and the people who run it.
I'm very deeply saddened, again, because of my long connection, my legacy with the university, to see this program ended. And the reason for that is that it was, up until today, was an extremely unique and I think tremendously important program. It was started early on by Edward F. Dow, who was a Harvard-trained PhD, who was part of the progressive movement. And so when Dow came here, he taught government in the history department before the political science department was formed. And his emphasis was on professional government, professional administration, to rid, you know, the corruption. And so he not only established a public management program as the first in the country, one of the first in the world, right here at the University of Maine, but he also worked in the field to encourage communities to establish the council manager form of government, to see it eliminated, and to see its place. It's almost like in the Soviet era, its very existence and history is expunged from the roles of the university. I think that the implications of it, I mean, we still have these needs, if not the same, probably in much greater demand today than in any time in history. We need real professional management. The need in Maine is extreme, and here we've eliminated the program that provides those resources. So that in the future, what you're going to get is you're going to get a lot of jobs in Maine are going to be filled by people who are from out of state. Major universities, a stellar reputation all over the country and around the world, are developing undergraduate programs in public management. Modeled on the one that we have here at the University of Maine, we have now eliminated. It's just, to me, there's an irony in this, that there's an irony upon irony. We were one of the first programs in the nation rostered by this accrediting institution, which meant that we had to go through an external evaluation, very rigorous external evaluation, and it was determined that our curriculum and our professors at the time met and exceeded national standards. And then we played a tremendous role, a very important role, in establishing the accreditation standards for NASPA. NASPA now has, I can't tell you how many hundreds and hundreds of members, how many programs are accredited around the world now by NASPA. And the University of Maine, again, ironically, with this elimination, was significant in the development and evolution. The department, as I said, eventually split, matured and split from the political science department because the missions were so different. We also were coupled with the Bureau of Public Administration, which now is the Margaret Chase Smith Center. And it was actually established by the legislature to be a part of the University of Maine to provide research to support local and state public administrative and policy efforts. To the extent that, at a period in time, the journal, but several major journals, but a journal in a national journal, very reputable national journal, listed our department here at the University of Maine in the 10 top programs in the United States for productivity in terms of research and publication. Eventually, the Margaret Chase Smith Center, the director, the dual directorship, left. There was an attempt to move the Department of Public Administration, which became the Margaret Chase Smith Center, away from the Department of Public Administration. As a matter of fact, to move it entirely out of academic units. A couple of things happened. We had a number of presidents, or a couple of presidents, who didn't understand public administration. Then we had, what I don't think is enough people appreciate, is that it became this sort of ideological thing as well. Business schools and conservative political ideologists began to look at public administration as sort of a leftist, progressive movement. The university had gone through a number of budget rescissions. The Department of Administration was allowed to languish to such an extent, even though we had a very robust graduate MPA student body. We had huge enrollments compared. Well, in just the last year, we were the ninth or 11th largest graduate program on campus. And I think when it came to recent efforts to sort of balance the budget, there was a desire on behalf of presidents, deans, and everyone to get credit for eliminating units, for making the hard decisions and to meet budget targets. And that we sat out there like a sore thumb in that we had four faculty lines, the rest were vacant. Of those four faculty lines, two people were at retirement age, one person was close to retirement age, me. And the other person, it was assumed, could be moved around somewhere. We went around one time, the faculty senate rejected all of the performance standards were supposed to be used to evaluate. They were never used. We were still put on a hit list. Then after the standards came out, they were misapplied to the university, to our department. For example, I, over the years, am proud to say that I've received stellar student course evaluations. somehow in the process, my course evaluations, which the university uses a scale from 1 to 5, 5 being, let's say, I forget how it worked, 5 being best, 1 being worst, in my case, had inverted every one of my evaluations over all the years of my teaching. So the conclusion was that rather than being a 5, which I have been consistently over these years, I was a 1, which was worse. And they'd done that not only with me, but with another faculty member in the department. So there was actually, I mean, the data was, I'm not saying it was done necessarily intentionally, but the data was met, was massaged to meet the performance review criteria after the decision had already been made. And even then, they couldn't make the decision.
The camaraderie of my faculty members and seeing the students in the hall, no one will be stopping by my office, whether it's in Augusta or in Portland, because they will be serving only master's students. Being able to just stop by the office and chat with people down the hall or in other departments.
Working with my colleagues, staff, and students, I enjoy having an office or two. Their challenging questions and comments made a rich and stimulating environment. So it's been really a wonderful ride. Being able to teach, do research, work as department chair, sometimes helping administration work and public service, listening and learning and talking with real manners. So it's really been a good.
It's going to be the people more than the intellectual endeavors, although you can't separate the two. It's been a marvelous combination. The interface I have with students and with colleagues, both in the department and throughout the university, are substantial, and I never really, I've taken them too much for granted, actually.
I love teaching, and I love the students. I mean, that's what I'll miss the most. I don't know what I'm going to do to fill that void in my life, it's the students. And the students have kept me intellectually fertile, and I hope I had a chance to keep them, you know, intellectually inclined. Also, it's given me an opportunity to have a major impact on state policy. Natural resource and environmental policy, I mean, I begin with a big idea, and I end with Plum Creek.
Think about all the skills you have and where you want to go. And you will have many, many careers. And as I said at the beginning, I had many careers too.
It would be a good idea to get at least two degrees, and I recommend the MPA, the MBA, and law. The internships are very important. It's a transition to your next real job. Be sure to visit some countries out of the U.S. because our own country is really having major problems, and we're hoping to get some new advice from some of these Europeans and other countries. You've got to get out of the U.S. at least once. It's my 40th year here, and I've been chair in and out of 20 of those 40. So let's just leave it at that.
It takes an extra bit of steeliness, actually, to put yourself into the public endeavor. I'm proud of what you guys are doing here. Go out and do great things. This is the best way to do it. And don't ignore the critics. Listen to them say, well, got a point here, not necessarily there, and go on and do what needs to be done.
You know, care about your neighbors. You know, be kind to animals and little children. I think, you know, if you get a chance to, you know, the glass half empty or the glass half full, it's always got to be the glass full, half full. Optimism, belief in people, and, you know, be gutsy, stand up, and embrace the future. That's about it. So, the meanderings of, you know, a once and never faculty member. Thank you.
to say. I can't do everything, well I can try. And as I roll along I begin to find things aren't always just what they seem. I wanna turn the whole thing upside down. I'll find the things they say just can't be found. I'll share this love I find with everyone. We'll sing and dance to Mother Nature's song. This world keeps spinning and there's no time to waste. Well, it all keeps spinning, spinning round and round and upside down. Who's to say what's impossible and can't be found? I don't want this feeling to go away. Please don't go away. Please don't go away. Please don't go away. Is this how it's supposed to be? Is this how it's supposed to be?